All right, Michael.
So
you think you got an answer?
Yeah, it's interesting. So I guess it really does make some intuitive sense that the line is really, really nailed down by the points close to it. And the points that are far away from it really don't have any influence. So I would put zero alphas on the lower left-hand minus and the one of the upper pluses.
Yes, and, you know, I haven't actually worked out the answer here, but both of these pluses probably don't matter. Certainly this one doesn't. Certainly this minus doesn't matter. Maybe this one doesn't matter either. But the point that you raise is exactly right. The points that are far away from the decision boundary and can't be used to define the contours of that decision boundary don't matter, whether they're plus or minus. Does that make sense?
Yeah, cool.
Does this remind you of anything?
Nearest neighbors?
That's almost always the answer. Why does it remind you of nearest neighbors?
Because only the local points matter?
Oh, that's a good answer. I was going to have a different answer. You know what my answer was?
What?
It's like K and N, except that you've already done the work of figuring out which points actually matter. So you don't have to keep all of them. You can throw away some of them.
Oh, I see. So it doesn't just take the nearest ones. It actually does this complicated quadratic program to figure out which ones actually are going to contribute.
Right. So it's just another way of thinking about instance-based learning, except that rather than being completely lazy, you've put some energy into figuring out which points you could actually stand to throw away.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's kind of interesting. I think it's kind of cool. So good. So you got that. Well, let me show you one more thing, Michael. All right, so you got this notion of there being very few of the support vectors that you need, but I want to point out something very important about some of the parameters in this equation. So we just got through talking about the alphas, right? Basically, the alphas say, pay attention to this data point or not. But if you look carefully at this equation, the only place where the x's come into play with one another is here. So Michael, generally speaking, given a couple of vectors, what does xi transpose xj actually mean?
It's the dot product.
Right. And what is the dot product?
It's like the projection of one of those onto the other, right?
Yeah. And that ends up giving you what?
A number.
Yes. Does that number kind of represent anything? And if you say the dot product, I will climb through the screen and kill you.
What about the length of the projection?
Right. And what does that kind of represent for you?
Well, I guess in particular, if the x's are, well, if they're orthogonal to each other, then it's going to be zero. But if they kind of point in the same direction, it's going to be a large value. And if they point in opposite directions, it's going to be a negative value. So it's sort of kind of indicating how much they're pointing in the same direction. So I guess it could be a measure of their similarity.
Right. I think that is exactly right. This is kind of a notion of similarity. So if you look at this equation, what it basically says, find all pairs of points, figure out which ones matter for defining your decision boundary, and then think about how they relate to one another in terms of their output labels with respect to how similar they are to one another.